concussion is not like a bone fracture, right, where it's all over in an instant. It's actually the beginning of a progression of symptoms, some of them lasting minutes, some hours, and some days. And what we see is that there are energy needs that change over time, the glucose metabolism, the cerebral blood flow, which provides important nutrients to the brain and oxygen, is decreased after a concussion. And if a repeated concussion occurs in the setting of an already compromised brain, then the response to that very same brain deformation could be dramatically different. And in the same way that Tori told us about her symptoms of subsequent concussions, or the next day when you had a second concussion, that's completely consistent with an injured brain being on top of another injury, and that's particularly devastating, with worse symptoms and more long-lasting symptoms. So we do know, the line is, if in doubt, sit it out. You should not go back into play until the symptoms are over. So the first risk multiplier, if you will, at a same level of acceleration would be, was there a previous concussion? Right. And how long has it been? And how severe were those symptoms of the previous concussion? I would say the second risk factor is age. So in the young brain, in the next slide, we see how the young brain is changing over time. And we see that the energy needs of the young brain peak early on, and that the cerebral blood flow is high then. And if those symptoms of concussion occur just with a decreased metabolism and a decreased cerebral blood flow happen just when the brain is needing it most for development, you can understand why there might be a vulnerability with prolonged symptoms that might even worsen over time. So these biological contributions add on top of the mechanical aspects.
This, is the most common cause of death
in kids.
In children.